I'm Francesca O'Neill. I am a barrister at One Chancery Lane specialising in professional negligence claims. And with me is my colleague Henk Soede, who also specialises in professional negligence claims. And we're going to talk about different topics today. Henk is going to go first. He's going to talk about damages in professional negligence cases, in personal injury cases. Many of you will have come across those sorts of claims which allege an undersettlement, for example. And so Henk is going to talk about that. When he's finished, we're going to move on. I'm going to talk about professional negligence and the assessment of damages in conveyancing cases. As far as I'm concerned, those are the two topics on which I am most frequently instructed to advise. The conveyancing cases are interesting and complicated. I was recently involved in a two-day trial which examined the scope of the retainer. So I'm going to start by talking about that, and then I'm going to move on to a recent decision last year in the High Court, which I think gives some really interesting gloss on the correct approach. But I'm going to let Henk go first. So Henk, are you ready?
Yep, we're ready.
I'm going to hand over the hot seat to you and let you take it away with personal injury claims.
Awesome. All right, well, good morning, everyone. And thank you very much for attending this talk. So my goal really is just to provide a brief outline of some of the professional liability issues that can arise in personal injury litigation, and in particular, the assessment of a loss of chance. So first, I'll briefly take everyone through some common issues on breach of duty and the relevant legal principles. And I'm going to end my talk by going through a case study I've prepared, which should, I hope, illustrate how the principles apply in practice. And if I have time, which is a big if, I'll also briefly discuss a relatively recent decision, which should provide a further illustration of all the principles we discussed today. So, hang on, slides, there we go. So, first part, breach of duty. As you'll all be aware, the relevant test is whether the advice or error or failure, whatever the case may be, was one which no reasonably competent legal professional practicing in the applicable field would have made. There's generally no requirement for expert evidence, at least so far as breach is concerned, because the court is generally deemed competent to adjudicate those issues. So personal injury litigation, like all other areas of litigation, is one where negligence can arise in a number of different ways. There may be issues with service of court documents and evidence. There may be issues with limitation. And there may be, for example, strikeout on case management grounds. But I'm not principally concerned with those today. My focus today is on the specific issue of undersettlement in high-value personal injury claims. So undersettlement can arise in a number of different ways. The most common areas which lead to undersettlement include settling in circumstances where medical evidence is incomplete, failing to properly calculate complex heads of damage, such as care costs or future loss of earnings, and admissions of contributory negligence in circumstances where such an admission is not justified. Now, the consequences of that negligence, particularly in this area, can be very destructive for claimants. So, for example, a claimant who's advised to accept a contributory negligence split of 60-40 may face a 40% shortfall in expensive and necessary care services. And the effect of that shortfall might well mean a very debilitating impact on the claimant's quality of life. So this really is quite a fertile ground for professional negligence proceedings. Now, I've included in the PowerPoint an excerpt from Lord Carswell's judgment in Moy and Pittman Smith. In brief terms, that was a case involving a failure to obtain medical evidence in good time. The claimant's case was worth about £100,000 without that evidence. But with that evidence, the claim was worth between £200,000 and £300,000. There were earlier attempts at adducing that evidence, albeit unsuccessfully, and the claimant was advised by counsel that there was a 50-50 chance that the trial judge would permit such evidence to be adduced. Now, at the doors of court, the defendant made an offer of £120,000, and the claimant was advised to accept that offer, having the security of a negligence claim against her solicitor. So she accepted the offer, sued the solicitor, and the solicitor in turn sued counsel. Now, the relevant point with this case is that the court will look at the context when adjudicating issues of breach. So in Moy, the advice was given under time pressure at the doors of court, and Lord Carswell was alive to the fact that such advice is oftentimes necessarily imprecise and often not as comprehensive as advice given in other circumstances. The key point, standard of care is not a counsel of perfection, and context matters. So that's really all I'm going to say on breach of duty for now. It's not really the focus of this chat, but hopefully it provides some context as to the sorts of issues that might arise. So before we deep dive into the topic of assessment of loss, it's of course important we keep in mind first principles. Listeners will be familiar with the six-stage test recently elucidated by the Supreme Court in MBS and Grant Thornton at Kahn and Meadows. I'm not going to go through that in any real detail here. Again, we're concerned today with the discrete issue of assessment of loss, particularly the assessment of loss of chance claims. I've included that in there really just for reference purposes. So, relevant principles. It is necessary, firstly, to take a brief look at the principles relating to causation in these sorts of claims, as these principles are fundamentally linked to those which apply at the quantum stage. So in any professional liability claim, the claimant's case on causation will generally be constituted by a number of interlinking allegations as to what both the claimant and various third parties would have done had the relevant professional not breached their duty. Importantly, the law as it presently stands requires different burdens of proof depending on whether the allegation relates to what the claimant would have done or what a third party would have done. And really the leading authorities, the recent, or relatively recent now, Supreme Court decision in Perry and Raleigh Solicitor. In essence, allegations as to what the claimant would have done but for the negligence need to be proved on the balance of probability, whereas allegations as to what a third party would have done but for the negligence depend upon a loss of chance valuation, and it's sufficient for causation purposes for the claimant to prove on the balance of probabilities that there is a real and substantial chance that the third party would have acted in the manner alleged. And I've set out the cases and the relevant paragraphs in the slide. So there's one further point I should make at this juncture. Just prior to the Supreme Court decision in Perry and Raleigh solicitors, there was an apparent consensus that a trial within a trial should be avoided. And this has now been dispelled summarily. So Lord Briggs makes the point at paragraph 24 of Perry, that there is no reason either in principle or in justice why there should not be an adversarial trial as to issues relating to what the claimant would have done. That is, issues which fall to be decided on a balanced probability basis. At paragraph 37, Lord Briggs suggested that this rule will not generally apply to allegations as to what a third party would have done. That is, issues which fall to be decided on a loss of chance basis. Now, the distinction is important, of course, for practical reasons. In one sense, what it means is you'll be able to throw the kitchen sink at the allegations regarding what the claimant would have done but for the negligence. And oftentimes in these sorts of trials, there'll be expert evidence on that. So in terms of quantum, even though it's sufficient for the claimant to establish that there was a real and substantial chance that the third party would have acted as alleged at the causation stage, at the quantum stage, the probability of the third party acting as alleged will be analysed and ultimately deducted from the notional value of the claim. Now, in many professional negligence cases, the question of how those probabilities should be assessed leads to highly contested issues of fact, and those are issues of fact which are often addressed by experts from a range of different professions. And so the assessment of that loss of chance is really what I'm going to be exploring in the next slides. So we've arrived at a case study. And before we deep dive into this, I really do need to emphasize that this is necessarily a crude example, and the analysis is similarly crude and oversimplified. My goal here is really just to provide a worked example, which gets us thinking about the points and principles I've been discussing so far. So I'll read out the case study, but please feel free to tune me out and read at your own pace. So the claimant suffers a head and shoulder injury as a result of an RTA. The shoulder injury resolves in 8 months. The claimant suffers persistent headaches for a year. The claimant's partner notes that she's exhibiting drastic and unusual mood swings at home. Claimant's solicitors instruct a GP expert to assess her injuries. GP finds it was probably a minor concussive injury, but he recommends referral to a neurologist for further assessment. The neurologist is thereafter instructed, advises that there is evidence of a traumatic brain injury. The neurologist recommends that the claimant's monitored by a caseworker for the next 2 years so as to ascertain long-term ability to work. Shortly thereafter, defendant makes a without prejudice offer in the sum of £70,000. Liability is not admitted. The claimant's solicitors advise there's a 70-30 prospects of success. The claimant's eager for the money, and the claimant's solicitors thereafter accept the offer on her behalf. Crucially, the claimant's solicitors do not advise the claimant about the potential future loss of earnings claim. Thereafter, the behavioural changes worsen, there's a deterioration in cognitive abilities. She instructs solicitors that she's concerned about her injury and about the advice she received prior to settling her claim. There's a medical legal report from a different neurologist who confirms a serious brain injury and advises that the claimant will, on the balance probability, be unable to work for the rest of her life. Advice is also obtained from counsel, who considers that, on the evidence he has seen, her claim was worth £700,000 at the notional date of trial. So there are, of course, obvious issues of negligence here. The claim is settled at a stage where the medical evidence is incomplete and the claimant's prognosis is unclear, with the backdrop being a potentially severe brain injury. The claimant may well have wanted to settle, but the key point is that she was not advised as to this big potential future loss of earnings issue. So we see here at step one a very crude analysis of the sorts of causation issues that might arise on these facts. So had the claimant been advised of a possible long-term inability to work, would she have agreed to instructing a caseworker? Had the caseworker been instructed, would a reasonably competent caseworker have identified the neuro difficulties over the two-year period and referred to a neurologist? Had the caseworker referred to a neurologist, would a reasonably competent neurologist at the relevant time have found that there was a 75% chance that the claimant would not work again? And had the claimant been advised of the value of her claim, given the loss of earnings issue, would she have settled at £70,000 in any event? And finally, had the claim been properly valued, and had all those steps been taken, would the claimant have won at the notional trial date? So firstly, in terms of the burden of proof, points A and D concern allegations as to what the claimant would have done. So for causation purposes, those points will stand to be determined on the balance of probabilities. By contrast, points B, C, and E concern allegations unrelated to what the claimant would have done. So at the causation stage, it's sufficient for the claimant to prove that there was a real and substantial chance that the third party would have acted as alleged. Now, I pause briefly to note that all of these points could, in theory, be litigated with full force. There may well be competing expert evidence as to what was available at the relevant time and what a reasonably competent neurologist would have decided. There may be extensive cross-examination of the claimant and her previous solicitors as to what the claimant would have done. And there are likely to be various arguable points about the prospects of the underlying claim succeeding. So, step two, let's assume for present purposes that the following is either admitted or determined by the court. Firstly, the claimant proves on the balance of probabilities that she would have agreed to a caseworker had she been advised of the potential future loss of earnings. Second, there are 90% prospects of a reasonably competent caseworker identifying the neural difficulties and referring to a neurologist. Third, 100% prospects of a reasonably competent neurologist advising that the claimant would not work again had the claimant been referred to him at the relevant time. Fourth, the claimant proves on the balance probabilities that she would not have settled at £70,000 had she known the future loss of earnings potential. Fifth, the claimant proves on the balance probabilities that she would have had a 70% prospects of succeeding had the claim proceeded to trial. So here we have, again, in very simplified terms, the assessment analysis. So firstly, you calculate what the claimant's claim would have been worth, but for the negligence. We've assumed for the sake of this analysis that the full liability valuation is £700,000. So the second stage, you discount the award against the loss of chance issues. Now, this, of course, involves an investigation into those issues, and there will, in almost every case, be a thorough analysis of the background facts and the various possibilities. So in our example, we've got a 70% prospect of winning a trial. We've got a 90% prospect that a reasonably competent care worker would refer to a neurologist. And we know that there's a 100% chance of a neurologist advising long-term inability to work had the care worker referred the case to him. So no issue there. Now, pausing there, in terms of how to value the 90% chance, there is an authority which suggests a 10% chance of something not happening would not fall to be discounted. And that decision is Asset Co. and Grant Thornton, which is cited in the slide at the bottom. So in essence, the court is not aiming at precision, but rather an approximation. And 10% has been deemed near enough to certain to warrant exclusion from the discounting process. So looking at the slide, the 90% is ignored. The only discount is the risk on winning a trial, which is a 30% chance of losing, 70% chance of winning. So you're left with a £490,000 figure. So the discounted rate is £490,000. You then discount for benefits actually received. In this case, the claimant, of course, received £70,000. And this gives us a total figure of £420,000. So clearly, this is a reasonably good outcome for the claimant. There was very little risk in terms of a significantly diminished award. And the claimant has successfully avoided what can, in some cases, be a brutal multiple contingency discount. Now, what I hope this emphasizes from the defendant's perspective is the importance of mounting a full-scale investigation into the loss of chance issues and the areas of the claimant's case that can be exploited. So in the case we've just been discussing, the only applicable discount, as you can see on the slide, was the risk of losing a trial. But what if there was another risk? How does that risk fall into the calculation? So let's assume that in our scenario, there was another loss of chance issue. let's say instead of there being a 90% chance of the care worker identifying the issues and referring to a neurologist, there was a 70% chance. So there's two loss of chance factors here. The 70% chance of winning, 70% chance of the caseworker referring. Both chances need to materialize in order for the claimant to win damages. Now, in the authorities, there are some competing views as to how the quantum analysis should be approached in multiple contingency scenarios. Now, in Asset Co. and Grant Thornton, the High Court analysed the issue as follows. If two given chances are independent and discrete chances, it's appropriate to come to an overall figure by discounting each of those percentage chances against the notional value of the claim. But if the two loss of chance factors are not independent, but rather fall under the same general risk, then the court will take a broad brush approach. So in this case, the 70% chance of winning and the 70% chance of the caseworker referring, those are independent risks. And so what you do, you take the £700,000, you discount by each of the two loss of chance factors, and the end result is a notional value of £273,000. So a very different result for the claimant. Now, I hope that that is a very or relatively useful illustration of how important it is to really interrogate the hypotheticals. So if you're for the claimant, you need to think about where there's weakness and how that can be addressed in evidence. If you're the defendant, you think, how can we exploit this and what do we need to do in terms of evidence? And even an additional 20% chance of a 20% deduction can, in the grand scheme, make a very real difference in damages. So I should probably hand over to you now, Francesca, because I have another case which I was going to discuss, but it will be on the PowerPoint and we will circulate the PowerPoint to all of you. So that should be in there. But this case really is quite a helpful example of this multiple contingency analysis in practice. And I've hopefully provided a relatively brief but useful summary. And on that note, I will hand over to Francesca.
Thanks so much, Henk. That was extremely helpful. I really think going through a worked example like that is of tremendous use, because many of those watching us don't deal with this sort of thing on a daily basis or weekly basis even. And so I think it really helps to see how you apply these quite complicated ideas to reality.
Definitely.
Don't worry, guys. We are going to circulate these slides. So everything at the end of Henk's presentation that he didn't have time to get to, you will have a chance to see. I am going to move on and talk about negligence and conveyancing cases. I'm going to start by talking about the scope of the duty of encapsulated in a solicitor's retainer, following on from a trial in which I acted successfully for the defendant. And in fact, I can see my instructing solicitor is watching. So she's going to be bored because she was sitting behind me through the trial. Sorry, Kitty. And then I'm going to move on to talk a little more broadly about the assessment of damages and conveyancing cases, looking at this Spire development and Withers case, and looking at, you know, again, working through an example, what is the best approach to working out what your loss of the chance is in a case where you're facing an allegation of negligence in the conveyance of a property. So next slide, please. Thank you. So I'm going to talk a little bit about this case, Harry and Curtis Law LLP. At the bottom of that slide is a link to Chambers' website, and it's a link to an article that I wrote, which is going to set out in a bit more detail all of those facts which I'm going to address now. So if I'm rattling through a little, don't panic. If you click on that link when the slides come round, you'll have an opportunity to consider it all in great detail and at your own convenience. This was an interesting trial because I think practitioners in this area feel that since probably SAMCO, but then more recently after the Grant Thornton decision, lawyers generally think that they understand how arguments on the scope of duty for professionals should work. The law is always developing, but scope of duty is rarely a controversial topic on which claims are won or lost. But that wasn't the case in this claim. In this claim, the purchaser of a show home on a large residential development in Derriford, Plymouth, got it wrong. She'd reserved, as I said, the show home on an early phase of the development. And when she went to see the property, it was already completed on a street of other completed properties. It was apparently a quiet locale. It was surrounded by other seemingly quiet residential streets. She liked that. She liked the house and she bought it. Her conveyancers were a firm of local solicitors who had acted for her on a previous sale. They had an ongoing relationship, and they acted for her on a low fixed fee conveyancing package of the sort that we see all the time. And the reason that I think this is an interesting case is because those low cost, high volume types of work are, you know, these are themes as applicable to personal injury cases as they are to conveyancing cases. So they were acting on a low fixed fee package. The scope of the retainer promised to investigate title, to perform local authority searches, and they did do all of those things. The local authority searches are key in this case because they did not give any details of any major road schemes within 200 metres of the house. In actual fact, on the face of the report, it said, are there going to be any significant road schemes within 200 metres of the house, or any highways, roundabouts? You know, there's a whole list of street developments that could possibly occur, and the answer to all of them was no. As a result of that, the solicitors told the purchaser that there would be no major road schemes, there was nothing to worry about, but the search was wrong. In actual fact, a major new highway called the Forder Valley Link Road, which was going to be a road developed linking, and I'm not from Plymouth, so you're going to have to bear with me. I wasn't from Plymouth at the trial either, much to the embarrassment of the judge, who was more familiar with the road schemes than I was. It was a major road development linking two major areas of the city. So it was going to be a relatively busy route. And this new road was to be constructed less than 50 metres from the front door of the purchaser's house. She sued her solicitors for breach of retainer, claiming that they ought to have advised her about the road. And it was, in effect, although there was some confusion about this, a no transaction case. Because what the purchaser said is, if I'd known about the road, I would not have touched this property with a barge pole. I wanted a quiet house on a quiet street. I wouldn't have bought it. There are three interesting features, I say, in this case. The first is the extent to which solicitors taking on that sort of large volume, low cost work, like conveyancing, like low value RTA, personal injury claims, can limit the scope of their retainer. This is an important point because we're not talking about the standard of the work that has to be completed. The standard must still be that of a reasonably competent and experienced solicitor dealing in conveyancing or personal injury or whatever it is. There's various authorities that go a little further on those points. I'm happy to add some of those to the slides. The most important is Thomas and Hugh James Ford Syme solicitors, which is a 2017 authority. There's also an accountant's case called Denning and Greenhull Financial Services Limited, also 2017, and that really illustrates the fact that you can't let your standards slip, but you can circumscribe and place limits on the scope of your retainer. And in my case, His Honour Judge Mitchell found that there was no obligation on the solicitor's part to advise on matters which were features of the wider development, as opposed to this particular property. And they were entitled to rely on the results of the searches, which did not raise any particular concerns, because, as I've already explained, the searches were clear. There were no road schemes to be constructed. This distinguishes an authority called Orient Field Holdings and Bird and Bird. In that case, a judge went the other way and said that actually the solicitors did have an obligation to go behind the results of a search if it seemed as though there was something a little off with the results. But it was a different sort of case where the house being purchased was being purchased for, I think, £25 million. And the solicitors were accordingly being paid an awful lot more to consider every detail. So again, it doesn't go to standard, but it does go, I say, to the limitations that one can place on your retainer. His Honour Judge Mitchell said, I don't think there was any need to make further inquiries or to read hundreds of pages of planning materials that related to the broader development. The claimant relied on an authority called Farragher and Gerber, where the purchaser was not told that the Limehouse Link Road, which, let me tell you, is a major highway, was built right outside her front door, and where her solicitors were clearly negligent because they didn't carry out their own searches. I think in that case, they relied on a photocopied search handed to them by another tenant. I mean, it was really a completely different scenario. Another interesting feature was time pressure. In this case, the constructors of the large development were a big national building company, and they offered incentives to purchasers to complete within 28 days of exchange, as a result of which the purchaser placed a huge amount of pressure on her solicitors to complete all of their searches, all of their inquiries, all of the correspondence, get the mortgage, all of those items which have to be ticked off your list before you go ahead with your sale. She wanted it all done, you know, tomorrow. So how does that have an effect on the scope of the retainer? It was, in actual fact, tantamount to bullying on the part of the constructors, and both the claimant and the solicitors said that in court. The deadline was achieved, but what role did this play? The solicitor's primary position was that it would have been impossible to undertake the wider investigations that the claimant said they ought to have undertaken within the time allowed. But more importantly, even if they'd had all the time in the world, they still wouldn't have gone behind the results of the searches. So it was, in some respects, a moot point. The court preferred that second argument, which was supported by the evidence of the conveyancer at trial. Extra time would have made no difference because there was no obligation to go further than the search. I think, though, that it's important to pick up on this, because professionals should really be alert that merely being under significant time pressure is no bar to a finding of breach in different circumstances. If it's not possible to undertake the tasks that you are required to undertake as per the scope of your retainer in the time allowed, then you must explain that in writing to your client and say no. If the court had found that there was a positive obligation to go behind the searches, but there wasn't enough time to do it, that would not have been a bar to a finding of breach. So I think that's a really important point if you take anything away from this. Lastly, and I'll be very quick on this, the quality of your expert evidence is really important. In this case, the expert evidence provided by the claimant was really quite amazing, because large sections of it had been copied and pasted from another report about a different claim, also the same development, but with materially different facts, such that there were various mistakes and errors in the report which weren't corrected before the report was exchanged, and which was, you know, extremely fruitful in terms of cross-examination. What I would say about this is, if you have an expert, however proficient, in the witness box, if there are problems with the report, you need to get those corrected before trial. And really, it needs to be checked extremely carefully before it's submitted. The other, and I think this is important, is the claimant's expert was clearly somebody with a subjective view that he would not have wanted to buy a house near a busy road. But there are other people for whom buying a house near a busy road is a positive asset, because it might be close to transport links, shops, schools, your place of work. But he allowed his subjective view to colour his expert opinion. And that was really apparent both from the report and the evidence he gave at trial. Of course, that's not the role of an expert. The role of an expert is to give impartial, clear, incisive commentary that the judge at trial will find helpful in making a decision on both the facts and on any other causation arguments. Lastly, I just wanted to touch on when you can claim for general damages for stress and inconvenience arising out of a professional negligence claim. I could do a whole seminar on this. You'll mainly be familiar with Farley and Skinner. It's quite an old House of Lords authority, which allowed claimants to claim for it. And in my claim, there was a claim for it. But I think it has to be pursued only in quite exceptional circumstances. It's not enough to say that because a professional of any sort is instructed, the object of that instruction is for peace of mind. In actual fact, the peace of mind is really a feature of the professional undertaking their duties to the relevant standard. So it's very closely interlinked, I say, with the way that a retainer operates and the scope of that retainer. In my claim, the claimant claimed that the building work and the foreseeable possibility of pollution and heavy traffic passing close to her new house had caused her distress and would continue to do so. There was no medical or other evidence in support of this. Her witness statement wasn't very detailed. She hadn't taken any steps to mitigate or avoid the distress. No detail of its impact was given. It was assumed that was not enough. You really need strong evidence that's cogent, that sets out clearly what the impact has been. And in actual fact, it's worth having a look at Farley and Skinner, because in Farley and Skinner, there was really cogent and clear medical evidence in support of the claim. So what was the result? The claim was dismissed. A significant interim order was made for costs. It was a success for the defendant in limiting the scope of the retainer. I'm very happy to answer any questions on that. But of course, you can read all about it if you click on that link. Henk, I hope you're still there. Can I have the next slide, please?
Yes, I'm still there. Sorry, I had to turn my video off because I think my connection was messing up the slideshow.
No problem. Can I have the next slide, please? Oh, yeah. Okay, well, and to the next one. I'm just going to touch very briefly on this case, and I'm certainly not going to set out in great detail what the judge said, because I have done that on the subsequent slides, which you'll have when I send them round. But this was a case where the purchasers of two very high value properties in London sued their conveyancing solicitors for a failure to advise them about power cables that ran underneath. The plan had been to add vast basements, which would have increased the value of the properties. The purchasers said they would have negotiated a lower price, and the court examined the correct approach. Next slide, please. His Honour, Judge Pelling, QC, was sitting as a High Court judge hearing it. I'm not going to read this out, but what he said very briefly was, the principles that apply to such a claim are now well established and are not in dispute. The claimants have to prove on the balance of probabilities what it would have done upon receipt of competent advice. But to the extent that the supposed beneficial outcome depends on what others would have done, this depends upon a loss of a chance evaluation. And again, that's really reliant on an authority that Henk already flagged, Perry and Rayleigh's solicitors, which is still, I think, a key authority in this area. Next slide, please. The court was concerned with whether the claimants had lost a real or a speculative chance. And so, returning to the test that the judge had to apply, it was for the claimants to prove that if they'd been advised of the availability of power cable searches, they would have undertaken the searches. And that would have had the effect that they then went on to say it would have. On the balance of probabilities, the judge found that the claimants would have asked for the searches to take place. Withers would have told them about the results of the power network's cable search, and they would have wished to negotiate a reduction in price, because of course the claimants wanted to acquire the site for development purposes, so they wanted to buy it at the lowest price that could be achieved. Next slide, please. There was a slight wrinkle in this, in that there were an additional argument about the duties owed by a receiver, and it was a receiver selling the properties. So if there's an additional burden on the receiver to produce information to a mortgager and any sureties and so, but I don't think that's strictly relevant to the quantification of damages point. What the judge said is, I conclude that the claimants have failed to show that they had a real or substantial, as opposed to a speculative chance, that they would have been successful in negotiating a further reduction in the subject to contract price of both properties. And so he rejected the claimant's claim that they should recover £800,000 under that head. I'll just pause there. This is really key, and you need expert evidence, and I'm going to come to that in a second, which shows that you not just would have done something, but it would have had the results that you say that it would have had. Perhaps that's a little convoluted way of saying what the judge said in this judgment, but it's really clear from this judgment that if you cannot show a real or substantial chance, as opposed to a speculative chance, well, I would have liked to have negotiated a discount, you're going to be in hot water. Next slide, please. So how does this work in practice? I'm going to briefly take you through the facts of a case in which I recently advised. I am conscious of the time though, so I think what I'm going to do is go through that really pretty quickly, but again, you will have the slides. In my case, a purchaser wanted to buy a second home for his family. It had a one-bedroom cottage. It was an annex. He wanted to let the annex out, both for security reasons and also because it would provide him with an income stream which would defray the running costs of the second home. So this house was particularly attractive to the purchaser for those reasons. Everything goes smoothly. He buys the house. Subsequently, it turns out that there's a restriction. The annex cannot be let out separately. And what the purchaser wants to know is how does he phrase his claim in damages against his conveyancing solicitors who should have told him about the restriction? Is it the loss of the income stream that he hoped to have, or is there some other measure? Next slide, please. Of course, the primary function of an award of damages is to put the claimant back in the position in which he would have been in but for the solicitor's negligence. We're all very familiar with that. Next slide, please. Ancient authority here, which confirms that the assessment of damages is ultimately a factual exercise. Again, we're not interested in speculation, we're interested in the brute facts. Next slide, please. Where a buyer is able to show that a solicitor has negligently failed to identify a defect in the property, or has incorrectly advised that it had specific features which it did not in fact have, so in this case, the ability to let out the annex, the normal consequence is that the buyer has paid too much for the property. So that's your starting point. It's known as the valuation method, and there are three different types. I'm not going to go through all of them, but you can see from the slide, there are different scenarios in which your measure of damages is going to be different depending on the factual scenario. Next slide, please. An interesting authority is one called Keeden Estates, and this was what the claimant, potential claimant in my case, particularly wanted me to look at, because in Keeden Estates, a court found that you could claim for your lost income stream. So there was a defect in the underlease of the property in that claim. Damages were awarded by reference to the return which the purchaser would have achieved if it had acquired a comparable investment property with similar yields, which didn't have the same defect. But Keeden has never been followed, and there's a really clear reason for that. In Keeden, the exercise was relatively simple in determining what the loss had been. The investment was, I think, a commercial premises. The claimant was a property investment company. There was expert evidence of other commercial properties. I think they were warehouses, very similar, that were on the market at the same time, what their yields had been. It was possible to undertake a fairly conclusive factual exercise on what the loss was in that case. And on that basis, Evans, Coombe, Kay awarded damages by reference to the return. Next slide, please. So could my client pursue their loss in the same way as in Keeden? I said, I think it's going to be a really uphill struggle. I don't see a problem with premising the claim on that fact, but I wouldn't rely on it. It's going to be an uphill struggle. In Keeden, it was a really clear, simple exercise as to what the determination of loss was. But in your case, the loss of income can't be easily determined. You don't know how many people would have wanted to rent the annex, whether they would have been holiday lets only or permanent. It's very difficult to find comparable properties which would have really elucidated any of those facts. To get expert evidence is going to be really difficult. Much safer to follow the valuation method as previously discussed, and which would be a calculation of the difference between the price paid and the price of the property with an unlettable annex. That in turn would require expert evidence. Let's learn the lessons of Spire Development and Withers, because if you don't have your supportive, conclusive expert evidence, which you can show the court as determinative of your loss, you're going to be in hot water. I think the conclusion, sorry. Henk, go back to the conclusions. We need to conclude.
Hang on, I've lost.
I think I can conclude fairly shortly. Expert evidence is going to be really key in any claim for loss or damages resulting from professional negligence. The scope of recoverable damages is flexible, but you'll see it's highly fact specific. Courts are alive to different mechanisms that would allow parties to recoup their loss, but for the alleged negligence. Loss of a chance calculations can be fraught with complication, and the best way to work it out is often with a diagram and a calculator. I didn't write that, Henk did, but you can see from his worked example why. So I'm very grateful to him for doing that for us. And please, if you have any questions at all or anything arising out of this presentation, don't hesitate to email either me or Henk. I think next slide, please. I think that our email addresses are there and they'll be on the slides when we circulate them. So please do let us know if you have any questions at all. We're happy to help.